वी गो इन डिटेल्स. लेट्स वेलकम आवर गेस्ट टुडे. आज हमारे जो गेस्ट हैं वो हैं अन्नु पिशावरिया. शी गॉट सो मच यू नो पर्सनैलिटी, आई मीन सो मेनी डिफरेंट आस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ हर पर्सनैलिटी. इट्स वेरी आई डोंट थिंक इट वी विल बी एबल टू डू द जस्टिस विद हर इंटरव्यू.
इंटरव्यू यस विद द इंट्रोडक्शन इवन.
यस तो लेट्स वेलकम अन्नु जी. अन्नु जी गुड मॉर्निंग, वेलकम टू द शो.
Good morning. It's so nice to hear you.
And first of all, Annu ji, पहले तो मैं आपसे complaint ही करूंगा कि because you were not able to come to the show.
I know. I have such a great regard for you and Mr. Ashok Tangri. You've done a wonderful job. And you know, we can't be in all places at the same time.
Okay. I know. I understand that one. Yeah, I know you had a seminar going on in Seattle that time. So,
yes.
So, anyway. So,
but as long as good people are doing good work in various parts of the world, that's all that matters, right?
ओके तो आज हम आपका इंटरव्यू कर रहे हैं, लेकिन आज फर्स्ट टाइम मुझे डर लग रहा है इंटरव्यू करते हुए क्योंकि एक अटॉर्नी सामने है.
अरे नहीं मैं स्पोर्ट्स पर्सन पहले हूँ, आप खिलाड़ी से बात कर रहे हैं. डोंट वरी अबाउट दैट.
तो भी खतरे वाली बात है.
अरे
खुशविंदर जी ध्यान से बात कीजिए नाप तोल के.
ओह दिस इज सो नाइस.
यस आई मीन यू नो देयर वाज सो मेनी थिंग्स टू टॉक अबाउट, लेकिन हम वी वोंट बी एबल टू cover all the aspects. So start with the attorney part first. So you are immigration okay. attorney, and you do practice in India as well as the USA?
हाँ जी बिल्कुल. I practice in India as well. Particularly India में जो property disputes होती हैं, international custody issues होते हैं, family law matters होते हैं, business visas होते हैं, I handle all those in India. I have an office in New Delhi, and I'm an immigration lawyer in United States. I've been practicing immigration since almost 1983 now, so it's been over 30 years.
Oh, I thought you're 35 old. Okay, anyway, so you look so young.
I like your show. You make us laugh.
And you sound so young as well.
Yes, yeah, I know. Because being a sportswoman, maybe that helps.
Yes, it does. It does. Yes. Absolutely. I mean, I was a tennis player, and tennis has helped me all my life, you know. It's unbelievable. Tennis, if you remember, I played Wimbledon in 79. I don't know whether you're aware.
No, I was not
Wimbledon
born that time.
Me neither.
No.
Anuji, you just gave us a hint.
No. वो एक्चुअली अनुजी उसकी बात भी करेंगे, लेकिन पहले आप इमिग्रेशन की बात कर रहे हैं. इस कंट्री में जो इमिग्रेशन इज सच एन इम्पॉर्टेंट इशू, आई थिंक आफ्टर गॉड अटर्नी इमिग्रेशन अटर्नी इज ट्रीटेड लाइक ए गॉड इन दिस कंट्री.
Yes, I understand. Because क्या करें, immigration system is so broken down.
Yes.
The system is terribly broken down. If you see the immigration policies right now which are going on immigration, I mean, Senate pass करती है bill and then what happens? It Congress is not passing the bill. And where they're trying to fix a broken system, I mean, it did get broken at one time, but they should be given an opportunity to fix it. If they fix it, all the people who are here will get a work permit, and also they'll be able to pay legally to the country, they'll be able to contribute legally, there'll be no hit and run cases. People, I mean, we really deserve this policy, but what is happening is that it's a political issue, and when anything becomes a political issue, you do not get results actually, because it's more about who is in power and how to, you know, show down another person. So that's the problem.
Yes,
biggest problem in immigration.
Yes, I agree. Politician doesn't matter if they are in India or they are this part, any part of the world,
yes.
They always take the mileage out of whatever they are doing and don't let other people work. And since you are talking about the immigration, what are these immigration reforms? So we all heard a lot about that, but I don't know in detail. So could you tell a little bit more about the immigration reforms to our listeners?
You see, the immigration reform bill basically says that people who have come on a certain date, cutoff date, and that cutoff date has to be decided. That cutoff date means people who've come before that will have a long line to get a U.S. citizenship. Now, it's not that they're getting overnight, becoming legal or something. The point is they have to go through a system. They have to check whether those people have given their tax returns for all these years. Now, some people may not have done that, so they might have to run and do their, taxes all over again. Maybe they have to go back and amend their tax return. There are just so many things in this immigration policy. But the problem is it's not going to get passed. Let me tell you that, the way it's going. So we people are going to spend so much of efforts trying to understand. I do not know, unless God comes from above and really puts a hand, will this thing be passed. So according to me, what is more workable at this time is, if that does not get passed, is that Obama passes some administrative reforms, which he is doing already. You see, they brought in a new policy. I don't know whether you're aware, there is a 601A waiver, which means anybody who's illegal in this country, if he has a hardship of any kind, now that hardship has to be strong reason. Supposing you have children in the country, supposing you have old parents in the country, or you have a wife who might have, say, for example, a medical problem if you go away. So when I ask some of my clients, do you have a problem? They say, no, there's no problem. But when I ask them, if your husband is going to go to India, he's illegal right now, what will you suffer when he's gone? Oh, they say, oh my God, there are so many hardships. How will I take my son to school? How will I take my parents to the medical center? How will I? Suddenly the entire hardship comes out. So all you have to do is document that hardship and file a 601A waiver. Now, there are already policies without the immigration reform that exist to help people. And that's what Obama is doing, passing some administrative reforms. We have to keep in touch with the new laws. If you go on my website, IndianAmericanAttorney.com, you will find me blogging about these new policies every now and then. And consult an attorney, consult an experienced person and ask them, do I qualify for this kind of a waiver or do I not qualify for this kind of a waiver? There's so many other ways of bringing people legally to the United States, and so many people, how to convert the people who are illegal here into legal status, which we can find even without the entire immigration reform. But, of course, nothing like immigration reform if it gets passed, but I don't see any hope, really.
Okay, thank you, Anuji. And I just want to remind our listeners, we are talking with Anu Peshawariya, the famous immigration attorney, and she practiced in India as well as in USA, and she got two offices, one in Bay Area, one in Seattle. So, Anuji, usi ko aage badhate hue, I just want to ask one more thing. You know, since you say hardship and all that, I know there's so many families, they got broken down because of immigration issues. Husband, they didn't get the visa, or wife didn't get, couldn't come here, and the family was, they had some kids. So either they were stuck in USA or they were stuck in India. So I know, I understand, and we can understand their pain. So we had to do some kind of, you know, reforms, as you mentioned. And I think people sometimes they don't go to attorney for the fear of I don't know how much it's going to cost. So they should consult attorneys and take their advice before they take any decision.
Yes. You see how much of money you spend in coming to overseas. Many people I've seen spend 30 lakhs of rupees just to enter a country illegally. They go from border to border, they scratch their knees, and they spend so much money. But if you call an attorney and if he says it's $100 consultation, it's 5,000 rupees. You spend 30 lakhs to come. You can't spend 5,000 rupees for just a legal advice which is going to take you right down the correct path. And I also understand from the attorney's point of view, because being a president of the Attorneys Association in many countries, I've seen that attorneys also have to pay for their living. They also have offices. They have to pay for their paralegals. They have overhead costs, which are so huge. So if they charge you $100, I think it's pretty fair. As long as you spend so much of money otherwise, I'm sure you can pay that $100.
I know. I agree with you, because sometimes people come to me too for consultation, and they do the same thing. They don't want to, but we don't charge any consultation fees. So anyway, so coming next to
you know, consultation is sometimes better than that. Let me tell you that. If you get free consultation, sometimes it just leads you nowhere. Whereas a consultation rather saves you thousands of dollars. Let me tell you that.
No, I agree with you. You know, since we are talking about immigration, and since you are an advocate of women rights too, so there are sometimes some issues where women, they suffer. They come to this country and their husbands, they treat them as a slave, and they don't get their passport done, and they don't get their immigration paper filed. So have you come across these kind of issues?
Absolutely. I, in fact, have written almost 3 books on that. One of them is The Immigrant Dream. Immigrant Dream deals with real case files, and it actually talks about each and every case which I've done. So there were like 10 examples of real life cases I've given there. So it's stories of Russian people, it's stories of African American, and these are not just stories from my brain. It's actual case files that I have, and from those I've explained how people came suffering to United States, and it also deals with a man's story. I mean, a man who came here. Let me give you an example. He was working for the overseas ministry, and he came here, and he was living here, and he had a son. He went back to India for some business. When he came back, his wife had divorced him ex parte and had married a U.S. citizen. So when he came back, she said, get out of the house. I'm married a U.S. citizen because I wanted a green card. He said, I want to meet my child. She said, go to court. Go and fight. So the guy kept on fighting, and I did his case too. It's in my book. So I do feel that it's not just women, but 90% of women suffer. So the analysis is that 90% of the cases that I've done are of women suffering from domestic violence, but once in a while there is a man too. So this immigrant dream deals with those stories which I've done. Go and read that book. It's on Amazon. It's available, Immigrant Dream. And there's another book that I did called Lives on the Brink. It actually deals with three different case histories of fraudulent Indian marriages. Now, I've explained how fraudulent Indian marriages occur. Like, I went to the Gurdwara when I first came to the United States, and there was an Indian Punjabi girl who was crying, and she came and talked to me, and she said, I want to tell you my truth of my story. And I said, what happened? And she said, I didn't know how to bring my sister from India, and I didn't know the immigration policy, so I thought the best way is to divorce my husband and allow him to marry my sister and bring him. I said, whoever gave you this advice? She said, all the family members and everybody said, you don't have to pay an attorney. All you have to do is divorce him on paper and we'll get married and then it'll be fine because nothing will happen. But what happened? The sister came back and refused to leave her husband. And her two children were on the road, and she was sitting in the Gurdwara and crying, where do I take my two children now? My husband is having fun with my own sister. What should I do? I felt so bad, and I just felt that's why I wrote this book, Lives on the Brink, and I made it in Punjabi also and went and distributed it free in most Gurdwaras. This book took me 15 years to research, and I don't know where to begin. These kind of stories come to me every day. There was another lady who the husband had two children. He never even filed her immigration papers. He brought her to United States, and he just kept telling her, I'll file your papers, I'll file your papers. She didn't know anything better. He didn't allow her to meet family, community outside. He just said, stay in the house. You need to clean the house, cook, take care of the children. So she never even understood that her papers were not filed, and she became illegal. And then he put her on a plane and said, go to India, I'll come back and fetch you, go for summer vacation. So she reached India, and then he said, he filed papers for divorce, did not even serve her. She came to me in India and she said, what do I do now? She went to the embassy, they said, you are illegal, it is your responsibility to see if your papers are filed or not. She said, in our country, India, he's God, my husband is God. I thought he was doing everything. How come he did not file my papers? Is it my fault? The embassy said, you cannot do anything. You are illegal. So in that situation, her one child was left in America. One child was with her in India. It was such a battle we had to fight. I thought of policies of how to help her, but it took me so long because the only way I could find out was I filed a case against this man in America so that she has a court case here. I got the court date, went back to the U.S. embassy there and said, how can she be defended on a case when she's not present? And that's how I got the humanitarian parole for her approved, and she came to United States, and then she fought for her child. I mean, these are the kind of cases we have to go through, but each case has a different answer depending on the facts and circumstances of the case. So these are the kind of cases I've done in Lives on the Brink, and that's available also on Amazon and on my website, Indian American Attorney. And then I did a third case, third kind of a book, which is a part of the same book. It's called The U.S. and India. It's called Bridging the Chasm Between India and United States. Now, in that, I've dealt with preventative measures of how you can prevent fraudulent marriages, what are the U.S. and India policies on various issues of such kind, what kind of conventions are there, what kind of international marriages are accepted in India, what are the outcomes of children born in the United States, and if somebody just takes them to India for a holiday and does not come back, which law will apply? Will Supreme Court of India law will apply, or will the U.S. court law apply? Who has jurisdiction? These are very, very few people have actually expertise in this. Because reading on internet is one thing, and actually doing these cases, going in India and doing these cases, and going in United States and actually filing these cases, I get cases. I'm not restricted to Seattle and California. My license is for the whole of the country because I do immigration. So I get cases from all over the country. The whole day my phone, I'm giving advice on the phone of such like cases. And people have to fight so much. That's why I suggested these preventative measures for girls before becoming brides and coming to America. And these policy matters which I have sent to U.S. and India are actually, I don't know how much they are doing, or is it just a book lying in one of the libraries, and how much of work is being really done on them. One needs to have a whole committee to see whether any one of those are being implemented at all. So I keep following up on these things.
Okay, let me once again remind our listeners, we are talking with Anu Peshawariya, the famous immigration attorney. So Anuji, if somebody want to read, I think you write the blogs too.
Yes, I do.
Okay, can
it's
you
all it's all IndianAmericanAttorney.com.
IndianAmericanAttorney.com. So listeners, if you need more information about immigration laws and immigration issues, you can just log in. Go ahead one more time, Anuji.
Indian American Attorney. So it's www.IndianAmericanAttorney.com.
You know, I agree with you. You know, one of my, you know, a very close known person, he did the same thing. He bought his wife from India and never filed the documentation, never filed for the green card. And she was keep on calling me, but she was not in California. She was some other state. I said, you know, I can't help you. I can't do anything unless we have to take a step. And the problem is the same as you say. They say our husband is a guard. We can't go against him. And these people, you know, these are the real human beings. They are so inhuman. They treat them as a slave. Yes. They don't file any paperwork. And they, if something happened, they just, same thing. They say, okay, let's go to India, visit our parents, and then leave them there.
And many of them take solace in saying, oh, I never made this thing. It was my parents who actually told me, go to India, try out this girl. I even told my parents I have a girlfriend. But my parents said, never mind, you know, forget about the girlfriend. You come, you will like this girl no matter what. I'm doing cases right now in Seattle where a man, a young boy, had gone to India and got married to a girl and brought her here and then refused to admit that she's his wife. I mean, I said, did you not sign all those papers? Did you not go when there was a marriage certificate? Were you not there when the marriage was performed? Were you not in the Gurdwara taking the steps before the Guru Granth Sahib? And he said, yes, I did all that, but she's not my wife. I said, then she said, my parents told me this. My parents told me this. This is very bad. Why do parents who have other girls also in their house give these kind of advices to their own sons? And then they bring them here and then they take ex parte divorce in 3 months without even serving the other party? So whose fault is it? Many times those parents also have mothers there. Why are they doing this?
I know, yes. We have to take as a step towards these people. You know, these people, and when once they take advantage of the laws, to their advantage, they misuse the law. So we have to take strong steps. And Anuji, we don't have too much time to discuss more on this subject. It was so nice to talk to you. And one more thing.
Yes.
I don't know most people know or not, but you are Kiran Bedi's sister.
Yes.
So.
Yes, very proud to be her sister.
I know. So you are younger or she is younger?
Oh, no, I'm the baby sister. She has raised me, I mean, from the childhood. She used to bottle feed me and, you know, so 17 years difference between her and me.
Okay, so ek behan jo hai wo thanedar aur dusri vakil. So people would be really scared to come and talk to you.
I know. I was her lawyer when the lawyer strike was there in India, and there were all the lawyers in India were on one side against my sister, and I was her lawyer fighting her case for the lawyer strike in India. And when I would go to the court, tears would come to my eyes, and my sister would say, "You cannot be my lawyer if you're so emotional." Yeah. I said, "Well, I'm a lawyer for the whole world, but for you, you are my mother. You're my sister." You see, so we have a relationship which is even unexplainable. She's more my mother than my sister. The age difference is so huge. So I love her the most, you know. And
okay,
that's
I know.
My
and
whole, everything for me is lying in Delhi is my sister. I don't have parents, so she is my parent and she has brought me up all her life.
Yeah, I know. And she made a good name in Delhi, and now she's in politics. So yes. You made a good name in sports too. So you represented India in Wimbledon. And I think yes. in 1982, you were the Asian bronze champion, bronze medal in lawn tennis.
Yes, I won the championships. I won the Canadian Open Championships, and I won tournaments in England. I won the Liverpool Championships, and I played Wimbledon in 1979 with even the year Virginia Wade won Wimbledon. And it was so amazing to be taken in the vintage car when Bjorn Borg and Jimmy Connors and Chris Evert Lloyd were there, and my little buggy came, and I got the standing ovation from everybody, because they said to get an Indian girl, first Indian girl to represent India in Wimbledon is amazing, because we know what all she has to overcome to reach this stage. So it's still a memory for me, you know.
Okay, that's great. So nice talking to you. Anuji, you are sportswoman, you are advocate, and you are author. So there are so many, you know, things we can talk about, but we don't have that much time, and we don't have time to discuss about your awards you got. You got so many awards. So listeners, if you want to see the award list of awards, go to her website and you can check all that. So we almost run out of time, Anuji. So I think we have to take...
No, tell them to just Google my name, Anu Attorney, and they can write to me, and I'll be more than happy to email anybody back. If they give reference of your radio program, I will answer them free of cost.
Okay, thank you, Anuji. Thanks, and hope next time I'll see you on the stage for other programs.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Anuji, for tuning in. Thank you very much.
Okay, Iraji, time fir bhag gaya. Aur
time
jate,
fir bhag gaya.
Yes, once again, we want to remind our listeners that Rabbi Shergill is coming August 2nd, Shabbo College, 6:30 evening is Saturday for the fundraising. So please do come and go to the event and like our page or just text me for tickets or just email me for the tickets and more information.
Absolutely. Well, Khushwinder ji, thank you so much for your time, and thank you listeners for tuning in. And suna na bhule khushi ke pal Khushwinder ke sang every Thursday at 10:30 a.m. Jiye jao, 30 a.m. Jiye jao, 30 a.m. Jiye jao.